actually a former graduate student of Penn and was a student under Mark. I studied in the Integrated Product Design program, but now I currently work for an engineering consultancy here in Philadelphia. Mark, can you give a quick intro about yourself?
My name is Mark Yim. I'm a professor in mechanical engineering. I've been here for 14 years? Yeah, 14 years. This is my third year teaching this particular class. There was another guy who taught this ESAP program before that. My specialty is robotics. That's what I do research in.
Okay, so the Engineering Summer Academy of Penn is a very unique opportunity for the students. They have the opportunity to live here on campus of Penn, kind of experience the university life and get a first-hand taste of what they can expect in the future. They live in the dorms, they eat in the dining halls, they work in the labs, and get to really appreciate what universities have to offer them in the future. One thing that's even more unique about the robotics program is that the students get to taste a really wide variety of subject matter. So subjects ranging from mechanical engineering to electrical engineering and computer science. That's really, I think, very, very valuable. Students going into the futures, they may not know exactly what they want to study, but to have such a wide and broad field and topics at their disposal, I think it helps really guide them in the future. Besides just guiding them in the future, having this experience, having this knowledge really provides them a leg up when going into their next steps. The content that they learn here is super applicable across all fields of engineering, even beyond that. One thing we try to focus on is teamwork and communication. That's definitely one of the challenges here. We form groups, so communicating, working in teams, sharing their ideas, and working together is integral to the experience, and these teams have performed extremely well doing that. Going a little bit further, so the project and task at hand this year is a musical instrument playing robot. So we have real world instruments ranging from guitars, drums, keyboard, other percussion instruments, and this is quite a difficult task. If you think of real-world instruments, they're designed to be played with the human hand, a rather complex human machine, and to replicate the motions, forces, and actuations needed to replicate the human hand or human body is often very difficult, and the students know firsthand how difficult that is. And one thing I first want to acknowledge before we even get started with the performance is how hard the students have worked. They've been spending late nights, early mornings, doing homework, working in the lab. So if we could just take a second, give a round of applause for how hard it's been. Great. Mark will touch on this further, but this group in particular has been very impressive. I think the fact that they emphasize prototyping, learning early, quickly iterating their designs and thoughts before going down a path that was too deep was really impressive. Some groups even went to the extent is incorporating a philosophy of working smarter and not harder, thinking of the simplest solution, refining that as much as they can instead of spinning their wheels and efforts on things that were maybe a little too hard for the time given that we were just limited and constrained by such tight deadlines and resources. And yeah, so through the rest of the day, we're gonna be playing some songs, demonstrating the students' hard work. As well, before we do that, one other really integral piece of the puzzle are our TAs and RTAs. Without them, not much of this would be possible. They, again, were the ones in the lab with students, late nights, supporting them in the dorms, making sure homework is getting done, entertaining them, showing them around the city. So just to recognize our TAs. Feel free to introduce yourselves later, but I'll do a quick introduction. So we have Noah, Ahmed, Lauren, Dinez, Tony, Jessica.
I'm over here.
And Sarah. Awesome. Okay. But yeah, thanks again for being here. Looking forward to a great performance. I guess looking at the audience is also another great cue. There's a lot of Penn students here that are here to view the demonstration just because they know the quality of the content and what to expect out of this program. Yeah, let Mark kick off a little bit more.
All right, thanks, Matt. Just one quick thing. This year, I think the show that you're about to see will be the most impressive show that I've ever seen among this class before. I have to be a little bit careful about what I say because we're live streaming. I also sent the live stream address to all of last year's students. these kids are they are building on the work that other students have done. They saw, we showed them the design so they could actually take it further, and they did. I think you'll see. I've been completely really impressed. They've done a great job. So just a little bit about what we will show you. We'll do two songs. We'll do one song in a minute. It's a song by Imagine Dragons, which a lot of the kids are know really well. There's a particular song that they're gonna play and sing that isn't as famous as some of their other ones. And then, for those of you who are closer to my age, they're gonna play a song from The Who. And we'll see if you can recognize that song. So between those two songs, we'll go through and each student group will talk briefly about their instruments, tell you what they did, and then we'll do the next song. And after that song, probably what we'll do is, well, depending on the time, we'll probably just let everyone come up and then talk to the different groups individually. Or maybe we'll do an encore, I'm not sure if we'll do that. Okay, should we get started? No, you're ready to go? Okay, so we have two singers.
Hello everybody. While we're waiting a second for some uploads to finish, I just want you guys to know that every single piece you see here, all like the pieces of wood, the plastic, all the lights, that's all done by students. That the RTAs didn't design that. Those are all done by students here. So it's really impressive because that's what we do in college. A lot of people don't get that experience until they get into college. So they have a lot of experience from this program. And it's super impressive seeing all the structures come together, all the hours of laser cutting, and fun assembly time, and a lot of hot glue, but it was fun.
Right now we're checking the Wi-Fi, make sure everything's working right. If you have phones and you want to put them in airplane mode, that might help. Thank you.
So our mechanism is basically drive the motor, which is attached to the drumstick, and then that reaction corresponds to that to the original state. So that way we have a repeatable and stable, yeah. And
So some challenges were getting it to play fast enough, so that's why each of these assemblies has two drumsticks in it, they alternate playing. Our original design was to have strings being spooled by motors, and that would pull the drumsticks. Overall, that was overly complex and didn't work as well, so we switched to this design. One unique thing about our code, and the reason that we're going first in this, is that rather than having a separate script file, a separate piece of code for each song, we just have one, and flipping a switch will change which one it plays.
Our design is really great, and we do so much for the first one, but anyway, this one works much better.
Hello everyone, I'm Bailey.
I'm Nancy.
And there's also a teammate from Luke, and he'll talk about it now. So our bass drum is quite simple and straightforward. The motor will drive the drumstick to strike. Strike the drum, and yeah, that's kind of simple.
So one of the challenges that we face is that the sound is too light. So we change the motor and also the size of the structure to make the sound much louder. And we'll take charge of the.
So can I show you the drum?
Okay. So my machine plays this drum by dropping marbles on it, which was very difficult. So put a marble in, and then these two solenoids activate, and they let the marble drop on the drums and the sound. So one problem is that the solenoids get really hot, so I might have to replace one. And then also, to get the marbles back up from the bottom to the top, I used to have an elevator, but it didn't work properly, so now I'm just taking them up and putting them back in.
You may also see the drawing on the picture.
Hi, I'm Mikio.
I'm David.
I'm Shishan.
We're drums, we're in charge of the hi-hat, first hi-hat, the snare, and the medium tom drum. We use a pretty basic design, it's the same as elevators, but one of the challenges is getting the timing right, the length of the fret, because if this fret, if the drumstick rests on the drum too long, it creates a
other challenge is on our circuit. Our power supply is either too high or too low on current. So we spend a lot of time on our circuit and try to solve the problem.
One of our biggest challenges was with the hi-hat. We only knew we had to do it like two or three days left, and we wanted to make it independent, so we had to figure out how to balance the weight. Like with the first design, it was falling a lot and couldn't work, so we had to work with that.
Thank you.
So we're the bass department. I'm Darian.
I'm Blue.
I'm
Alvin.
I'm Yvette.
And also another group member, Alex, is up there offering the cameras.
Since we've heard the or we saw videos from last year, which the last year's bass guitar did not work, so we assumed it was a very hard instrument. We decided to play it safe, and that's why we instead of mechanically fretting the neck of the stem of the guitar, we have just made clamps that clamp down in the proper fret position, so we don't have to mechanically fret.
In addition, because the it takes so much force to actually pluck the strings of a bass, we developed a new method of kind of plucking the string. We just use these solenoids, which kind of act as, well, pistons, I guess. And like a hammer and a piano, they just pop down and touch the string, which acts as their plucking.
Hi, I'm Kate.
I'm Simon.
I'm Sid.
So we are a guitar group, electric guitar, and we had to make two mechanisms. One is strumming mechanism, and one is pricing mechanism.
So one challenge we faced during the coding part is that the coding always works, like, I think it works in theory, but actually it doesn't work for this this servos and this mechanism. So I use a lot of time to like change it and improve it.
This LED thing on top, it's supposed to have a microphone connected to it, so when the music's played, like, it's supposed to play according to the sound, it's going to change without like switching off the lights. And for the rack and pinion, like, we have bump thing on the other side of this board, so like when it goes under it, it's going to press down on this rack and push down the string on the cord, I mean string on the fingerboard, so it's going to pinch the notes.
Yeah, and another one of the challenges that we faced was getting it to play fast enough and like having the two independent parts we had sync up. And one of the ways that we had to combat that was, as you can probably see here, it's got four different arms that are all doing the plucking because we need to be able to play fast enough. And another thing is, in the back here, just getting it to sync up, that was a lot of coding work, and that was what John designed was talking about.
Really big piano and manager.
I'm India.
I'm Jonathan.
I'm Sophia.
So first of all, as you can see in the design, we've used four servos to play the big piano. Originally we had two ideas. One was using solenoid to play, and the second one was using the servo to play. The first idea is the solenoid. Before, you need to play the keys on the big piano a lot. Therefore, we cannot use the solenoid for the solenoid. Therefore, we rejected the first idea. We need the second idea, which is using the servo. And when we used the servo, it did provide enough force to press the keys, but therefore we went with the servo design. During our design, we faced a lot of difficulties because we need to measure all the height we need to play the keys, and we need to measure all the angles we need to play. And one of the bigger challenges would be the coding.
Yeah, so one of the biggest challenges we met is that the servo cannot get to the position precisely. And for that, we timed the servo into microsecond level instead of millisecond level, and it works.
Hi, I'm Andy. I work at the Tarkan Group.
I'm Zohar.
I'm Naveen.
And I'm Boyan. So basically, we came up with this idea based off a YouTube video, so we took the inspiration from that. And the name of our robot is the Holy One. As you can see, it has a lot of holes. And basically we had to play eight keys. And so we chose motors. So basically one motor is controlling two keys so that we can have less programming. And the good thing about this thing is that it's simpler comparatively, because it has eight keys, but we only have to program four motors. And it's modular because every single part, as you can see, is like Lego. So basically, we can like assemble it however we want to. And like, it also has some shortcomings. So basically, a good robot has to be simple, robust, and repeatable. As you can see, this robot is like very, very simple, and it's so robust that we have to cut in every single screw after playing it. I think that's it.
I think one of the hard parts that we was the consistency, because all eight of our arms are right next to each other, and there's a lot of times where they'll either like not play a note or it'll play the note that goes to the left of it or something, and we have to correct that all the time. So I'm glad we were able to fix that.
This is Chet.
I'm Juliana.
I'm Olivia.
So we're the Tally Tubies, and then all we do is like play tubes. And then we have like a DC motor to pull it down, and then a rotor to pull it up. Then you can actually play really fast.
Okay, and we faced a lot of difficulties along the way. One of them was to get a good sound when we struck the tube, to have a good vibration go through. And another was to play fast enough for our second song.
Hi, I'm Alvin.
I'm Elisa.
I'm Sabros.
So we actually have two instruments. Our first instrument is the bell, which we use
actuator that basically just comes above down and up to get a turn. Our second instrument is the xylophone. And so for the xylophone, we have several, we have eight notes that we have to play. So what we ended up doing is we use these solenoids, which are like actuators that are this big, and then they have a piece that goes down and up. So we strike the xylophone in order to make the sound.
And the hardest part in programming is that after we spend lots of time writing complicated code, we will be stuck in like stupid bugs, like missing brackets or like the power supply is not on. So but after we have figured it out, it feels really cool.
Another problem we had with the project that we need to play on is very quickly. We have to figure out what we have to get, like the timing, right? Like we have to coordinate it correctly, because like we play it together at the same time.
Hi, we're the Coffee School Group, and I'm Alyssa.
I'm Lynn.
I'm May.
I'm Isma.
And our robot's name is Dinky, because whenever you strike the keys, it sounds like a dink. Our robot has two main components. One is the component that actually strikes the key, which tells the mouse to hit it. And then we also have the component which moves the turntable to hit every one of the keys, which is mounted on a motor which turns so that it can reach all the keys that we need.
One of the hard parts in Dinky was to get the mallet to strike the keys on time. Because not only do you have to raise the bar up and hit it, you also have to move to the correct position so the street could get it on the right time.
Okay, let's give them all a hand for the. So this next song, we have two singers, same ones, and we also have two violin players who will play. Unfortunately, I forgot to bring the music stand, so we have a human music stand. So if you want to come on up.
Before we continue, I would like to take some time to show appreciation for our two teachers. Dr. Raymond, Mr. Brandon, or Pat, and so we actually bought these posters, and we have everyone in the class has signed them.
Yeah, appropriately.
Yeah, one is the Infinite Imagine Dragons poster, and the other is a Who poster. So we'd like to. Thank you.
any questions while you good? Anyone have any questions? No? Okay, good. Okay, so I've got a question here. How did we pick the songs and the singers? So this is the first year that we're actually doing two songs. In previous years, we did one song. It turned out that I found these two songs that had mostly the same notes. So we managed to do two. The first one is, as you saw, is relatively slow and relatively simple. The next one we're going to do is much more complicated. So it's a lot of fun. Basically, I went through and I happen to like Imagine Dragons, and I happen to like
the singer.
This is interesting. I emailed the class before anything happened. So at the beginning of the summer, I emailed all the students saying, we may have music involved. Here's a list of potential songs. I also asked the kids what they liked. And is anyone interested in singing or doing other things? And both Melissa and Kate said that they wanted to sing, they have some musical training. And then, completely to my surprise, David and Andy said, or actually David first said, I play the violin. And then I looked at this, you know, this flute song, and there's a violin solo, and it's perfect. So they decided to play the violin as well. Yeah, question. Okay, that's the main difference from this year as the previous years. It's really hard. So they spent a lot of time trying to figure out exactly what the delay is, and they compensated for the delay. They tell the thing to go, and then it takes time for the note to hit. So figuring out how long that is, putting it in the code, adjusting everything. They get a Wi-Fi, signal that all for the synchronization, but they had to figure out how to get it to be synchronized. All the devices receive a communication from, okay, so one little secret. Noah is our conductor, but he's fake. Juliana is the real conductor. She presses the button and sends the Wi-Fi signal for them all to work. And just other one quick thing. Half the instruments also have the ability to